Well, good Sabbath morning. What a blessing it is to be worshiping with you here in person and online. It is a beautiful day. For those that came in, you probably saw that a couple streets over Monument Avenue, we have the Monument 10K. So if you're listening online as you're driving here, for one, don't watch us, just listen. But also make sure you go on 195 or something to avoid the runners. When I came in, the bridge was full of people running, which was nice to see in our community. So remember them and remember to drive around them as you come to church this morning. This weekend, we have our Pathfinder group is out camping with several other Pathfinder groups in the area. So a big group of them are out camping this weekend, and they're excited to be doing that. And they have a nice outdoor church service all together, and they are being blessed this weekend with that. I also want to let you know that, if you've probably seen in the bulletin, this afternoon there is the women's tea that is going to be in the fellowship hall. It's from 4 to 5:30. However, Rachel would want me to tell you it was something you needed to sign up for earlier. If you have a burden to come, which I hope that you do, women, want to come, and you have not signed up, please reach out to her and see if there's any new spots available, because I know that she wants every place filled. It'll be a blessing this afternoon. I regularly have conversations, or frequently have conversations with people at our church who want to be able to make more connections with people throughout the week, call them, text them, get a hold of them. I had that conversation last week, but aren't able to find their contact information. We are aware of this, and so we are working in the process of creating our church directory. Get more information about that. Terry Reynolds is the one who's kind of heading that up at this point, and she will hopefully be in contact with you. It'll take a while for us to do this, and it is optional. You won't wake up and find that everyone has the private number you don't want them to have. It'll be for your choice what you would like to include, and we'll be taking pictures for your option as well if you would like to choose that with your family or individually to be included in our directory. So stay tuned. We'll have more information with that. We love it when you guys are able to, or when everyone is able to connect in community. Also, we have our VBS coming up, so keep listening for that, and it'll be from June 10 through 14, so don't book your vacations at that time so that we can support the VBS ministries. And just one more announcement from me. We have coming up on May 10 and 11, Pastor Philip Simon. I never quite had a class with him. I wish I did. But he was a professor at Southern Adventist University when I was there. I do clearly remember, and this is probably the best thing I can say about maybe any professor, is that sadly there weren't enough professors who would go and eat in the cafeteria with the students. But on a regular basis, I don't know how frequently he did it, and you're nodding your head, you saw it too. Philip Simon would come in to the cafeteria and intentionally sit with the students, and he loved talking, interacting with all the students. He had a love and passion, still does, for Christ and the students that were at the school. And so I encourage you to come here and invite your friends to hear about Jesus' salvation shared by Pastor Philip Simon. Ms. Cheryl Van Ornum has a few announcements as well.
Good morning, everybody, and happy Sabbath. A couple of things. The women and children are invited to sing on Mother's Day Sabbath, which is May 11. That will be the same Sabbath that Philip Simon is here. We are going to sing Fairest Lord Jesus. I wrote the music out, three verses in the key of D, and then we're going to change to E flat major with a descant on the last verse. And so I have this music all ready for us to go. We have several different ways of rehearsing, and so we're going to meet today after Sabbath school around 12:45 here in the church, and I don't want to practice for very long because I know people have to get home to eat, so we won't be very long. If people could come up here as soon as they can And then we'll be, I sent out an email. If you're interested, contact me if you're not on my email list. And so there's other times to rehearse. And then also, I just wanted to say that I finished the 10K yesterday. It is now being done virtually, so you can do it on your telephone, and you don't have to do it with all the crowds of people. So if you're interested, we can start a club to do the 10K virtually, probably start in January, and start training then. I've been training since February. So, okay.
Thank you. And I did forget one more, a couple things to say. Very important, our pastor, Pastor Isaac, has safely made it to Egypt. He was texting with us this morning. He is enjoying a wonderful Sabbath with his family and other community today, and will be starting his training for 2 weeks of local pastors tomorrow. So pray it's going to be intense for him and the pastors. It sounds like they're jamming a lot in there. And we are blessed this morning to have Rudy share our sermon in his place. And I guess one more short thing. I was blessed this week. I know a few of you were to go to the theaters to see the Seventh-day Adventist film, The Hopeful. It was really, it was almost like going to church in the evening. We had a lot of local people from our school, Richmond Academy, and other churches and this church who had gathered to see the film together. And it was cool to see the message of our church up in a public theater. And so I believe the film will be out, I don't know exactly when, but will be released in other forms in the future, so we'll keep you posted about that. Thank you, and be blessed.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Please join me in the call to worship, number 878. This time there is no bold print for you to read, but you can follow along with me. This is taken from Hebrews 10, verses 19 through 22. So now, my friends, the blood of Jesus makes us free to enter boldly into the sanctuary by the new living way which he has opened for us. We have, moreover, a great priest set over the household of God. So let us make our approach in sincerity of heart and full assurance of faith.
Now, if you all could stand, we're going to sing Worthy, Worthy is the Lamb, hymn number 246.
Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much that you have given us your presence this morning. As we worship you, dear Father, we invite the Holy Spirit to be in our hearts, open our minds, and help us to renounce our sin, especially of pride and self-sufficiency. Thank you for answering our prayers. Forgive us of our sins in Jesus' name. Amen.
For I was blind, and now I see. In the words of our first hymn, it was at the cross where I first saw the light, and it was there by faith that I received my sight. Let us join in singing this group of songs dedicated to the cross. Number 163, At the Cross.
Sacred love for someone's eyes.
song talks about the roles that Jesus plays in our lives. He is our Savior. He is a friend for sinners. He is our strength. He is our help in sorrow. He is our comfort in sorrow. Because of the cross, he gives us forgiveness, and he promises to be with us forever. Jesus, what a friend for sinners. It's hymn 187.
The old rugged cross for the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. He gave us life through his death that we might have eternal life if we follow him. Hymn number 159, The Old Rugged Cross.
Thank you.
Read with me in Hebrews 1:1-4. Thank you. Hebrews 1:1-4. In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification from sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty of heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. Please kneel with me as we have a prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, it is so great to have the privilege to approach your throne, the throne in which you returned after coming down to save us from our sins, to be with us. Lord, we long for the day when we stand face to face with you. And in anticipation of that, we seek you this morning. We seek to find you, to be with you, to enjoy your presence as you enjoy ours. Lord, how magnificent and wonderful you are. Lord, may we not only seek to join you with ourselves, but to bring as many friends, families, and strangers along with us to your throne room to rejoice and celebrate with you. Dear Lord, bless this Sabbath day. In your name, Jesus Christ, amen. We are grateful to have you guys gathered with us this morning. We have chosen as a community to move most of our worship through financial giving to online. And you can find a link to how to do that on our website. However, if you would like to give in person, we do have envelopes in the pews and a box in the back with the lock that you are welcome to give your donation to tithes and offerings and to many ministries that are local here and beyond. This Sabbath, any loose money is going directly to our church budget to help facilitate our local ministries, including our lights and air conditioning and facilities. And so we pray that you will give as the Lord leads you. At this moment, it's a little different timing in our service, but I'd like to invite Teresa up here to share with us. Teresa was committed to taking home the robe and Bible with her to pray for someone to come to church this Sabbath. And while you listen to her, I would like to have you guys think about who would like to step up to do the same this week for someone else. I briefly got to talk to Teresa about her week with the robe and Bible. And do you want to share with us what? And you can step up, maybe one. Oh, hey. So you're good.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath.
I was touched by taking this to one of my friends where I live. And
she actually let me pray for her. And we both put our hands on the Bible, and we just started praying. I'm trying to get her to church, because I know she will love y'all like I do. And that's about it. I'm not a good speaker.
That was beautiful, Teresa. Thank you. It is so cool to not only pray for, pray for someone, but with someone. And I love that model, Teresa. It's easy to tell people, I'm going to pray for you. But I want you to take her witness and encourage you when you have the opportunity to pray for someone, also pray with them. And I'd like to invite anyone who would love to take this home this week to keep it near them, to pray over someone that they believe is God is guiding to worship with us. Is there anyone who's willing to do that this Sabbath? Yes, please, come up, Mark. Please. And let me have a prayer with you. Heavenly Father, Lord, how cool it is to think about those that Mark is praying for this week. Lord, I pray that you reach in their hearts and you work on them and you guide them to come and worship in our community. And more importantly, your community, Lord. Please bless him in his prayers and bless the person and the people who he's praying for. Thank you, Lord Jesus, in Jesus Christ, amen. Thank you, Mark. At this time, we'd like to invite the children forward to hear a wonderful story that I heard practiced this week by Miss Giselle Wilson.
I think most of them were whisked away to camp. But whoever's here, coming up, I still have a story for you. Kinley got a preview, so she already knows. Hello. Hi. Hi. Hello. Okay, so the title of my story today is Lily and the Peaceful Stream. In a small, lush village, there lived a young girl named Lily, who loved wandering by the stream that flowed like a ribbon through the heart of a green valley. This stream was not just any stream. It was a place where Lily felt a deep peace whenever she sat by its banks. One sunny morning, Lily met an old woman named Mrs. Olive by the stream. Mrs. Olive was humming a familiar tune, which Lily recognized as her favorite Sabbath school song, Peace Like a River. Do you guys know that one? You all know that one? Yes. She asked Miss Olive, "Why do you sing that song?" Miss Olive smiled gently. "The song reminds me of Isaiah 66, verse 12, where God promises peace like a river. It helps me remember that God's peace is ever flowing and abundant." Intrigued, Lily and Miss Olive sat down on the grassy bank as they watched the water flow smoothly over the rocks. Mrs. Olive shared stories from the Bible where God brought peace in the midst of storms. She told her about Jesus calming the storm with just his words and how Daniel felt peace even in the lion's den. Feeling inspired, Lily thought of times she felt worried or scared. "Mrs. Olive, can we sing the song together? I think it will help me remember that God's peace is always with me," Lily suggested. With a nod, Mrs. Olive began to sing, and I want everyone to join in with me as we sing. "I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like river in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like river in my soul." As they sang, a group of children from the village, drawn by the melody, gathered around. They too joined in, their cheerful voices filling the air with warmth and joy. From then on, the stream became a special place for the village children. It was a place where they learned about God's peace, shared their fears, and found comfort in the stories and songs about God's love and his protection. So whenever you are feeling just a little bit scared or a little bit worried, just remember that tune, I've Got Peace Like a River. Will you guys do that? Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for your peace. As soft as a river flows, just the calming sounds of water can just bring us to peace. Sometimes it may not be as peaceful as the river around us, Lord, but you said that you will always be our peace. So Lord, when we are scared, when we are worried, we ask that you be our peace, and we are reminded of that song that is placed on our hearts. Thank you for all that you've done for us and you continue to do for us as we go through this Sabbath. Be with us through this day. In your name I pray, amen. Thank you for sharing that song with me.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to everyone. Today for our scripture reading, speaker has chosen text from the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I'm reading from the King James Version. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doeth so easily beset us. Let us run with the patience the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. May God bless the portion that is read.
Abba Saba. I'll be singing from SDH 255, I Cannot Tell Why. I cannot tell why he whom angels worship should set his love upon the souls of men. Oh, why a shepherd he should seek the wanderers to bring them back, then or not how nor when. Lord, stays us here. cannot tell how all the lands shall worship when on his beating every storm is tuned. All who can say how great the jubilation when all
Thank you, Brother Uchi, for that wonderful song. Happy Sabbath day. Eli and Miriam are back. Nice to see you here, back again in church. Congratulations. When Pastor Hannah told me, Rudy, can you do the sermon on the 20th? Initially, he said, in May. And then when I was like thinking, that's another couple of months ago. And then all of a sudden he called me up and said, "Hey, it's April." So I was like, "All right, what am I gonna say, right?" And then I prayed. And after I prayed, all of a sudden I told my wife this. It's like my mind is cleared of what to do. So the Holy Spirit is really working in me. And so I hope and pray that you are ready, that your heart is ready for the sermon this morning. Any of you have their own Bibles with you today? Or do you have your virtual Bibles? There you go. All right, okay. On Good Friday, March 29, 2024, this is just recently, Ruben Inahi, a 63-year-old carpenter and house painter in Pampanga, Philippines, was nailed to the cross for the 35th time as part of a reenactment of Jesus' suffering on Good Friday. The real-life crucifixion has become an annual religious spectacle that draws tourists to the province about 80 kilometers from Manila. He said he considered ending his annual religious penitence due to his old age, but he could not turn down requests from sick relatives and villagers. He also said he would pray for peace in the Ukraine, in Gaza, and the disputed South China Sea. The question is this: why did Jesus have to die? I know this talk should have been given during Holy Week, right? Romans 3:23, everybody knows this text. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And in Romans 6:23, it says, and the wages of sin is death. We don't need to nail ourselves to the cross ever, not even once. Amen? Jesus did it all. I was reading The Desire of Ages, and in page 83, this struck me. I know this is like everybody knows this, or this is very popular. And this is what she said in The Desire of Ages. It would be well for us to spend a thoughtful hour each day in contemplation of the life of Christ. We should take it point by point and let the imagination grasp each scene, especially the closing ones. As we thus dwell upon his great sacrifice for us, our confidence in him will be more constant, our love will be quickened, and we shall be more deeply imbued with his spirit. If we would be saved, at last we must learn the lesson of penitence and humiliation at the foot of the cross. So we will do just that today. We will spend a thoughtful half hour letting our imagination grasp each scene of Jesus' suffering and death. Open your Bibles. I hope everybody has a Bible. Or in front of you in the pew, there is a Bible in there. To John chapter 19. We would be reading John chapter 19, verse by verse, and I would once in a while stop and explain something right now. We will do a lot of Bible reading today. And also, remember the story of Jesus talking to two of his followers, walking to Emmaus? Remember that one? As they were walking back, Emmaus is about 7 miles from Jerusalem. In Luke 24:27, it says, "And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he, Jesus, expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." Don't you want to hear? If only you were there listening to what Jesus said to them, right? We will touch on some prophetic verses today concerning Jesus' death and crucifixion. Also, I hope that our hearts will burn within us as we review some of these verses. Let's go to chapter 19, verse 1. This is the soldiers mocked Jesus. "So then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers twisted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe. Then they said, 'Hail, King of the Jews.'" They mocking him. "And they struck him with their hands. Pilate then went out again and said to them, 'Behold, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no fault in him.'" Verse 5. "Then Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and a purple robe. And Pilate said to them, 'Behold the man.'" Let us pause a little bit and let's talk about crucifixion. Crucifixion is a Roman punishment that Rome perfected. Before Rome, they were crucifying people already, especially the Jews themselves, and Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. It is a gruesome, cruel, inhumane punishment, especially for criminals who are rebelling against Rome. Crucifixion begins with scourging. What is scourging? It's whipping. The victim is stripped naked. Nothing. You know, We look at the crucifix right now, and you see Jesus in there, and he has something on his waist covering him. But in real crucifixion, the person is naked. And then he is tied, the victim is tied to a post like this. There's a post in there like this, and he's tied in there. And then he is flogged across his back, his buttocks and his legs. What is the whip is called a Roman flagrum. It is a short whip. It's made of three or more leather straps connected to a handle. The leather straps, though, were knotted with a weight at the end and embedded with metal, nails, and bone shards or a hook. Scourging would quickly remove the flesh, leaving flesh hanging like ribbons and would expose a bloody mass of muscle and bones. The next step is they would make the criminal carry the wooden beam of the cross to the place of crucifixion. Then his nails, or her nails, her hands would be nailed to the cross and then followed by the feet. Let's go back to verse 6, chapter 19. Therefore, when the chief priests and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "You take him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." 7. The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to our law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." Therefore, when Pilate heard that saying, he was the more afraid, and went again into the praetorium, which is the headquarters, or the barracks, and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Let's pause again. In Isaiah 53:7, it says there, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth." Verse 9, and went again into the and said to Jesus, verse 10, then Pilate said to him, "Are you not speaking to me? Do you not know that I have power to crucify you and power to release you?" Jesus answered, "You could have no power at all against me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who delivered me to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, saying, "If you let this man go, you are not Caesar's friend." This is the emperor. "Whoever makes himself a king speaks against Caesar." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus out and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Number 14, now it was the preparation day of the Passover, and about the sixth hour. Preparation day is Friday, right? And the sixth hour is noon. Remember, they don't have watches during those times. The first hour is, you start counting the first hour when the sun comes up. And this is in the Middle East. And he said to the Jews, "Behold, your king." But they cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but Caesar." 16. Then they delivered him to be crucified. So they took Jesus and led him away. Let's go back to Isaiah again. Isaiah 53:5-8, it says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." Verse 6, "And all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut from the living, for the transgressions of my people he was stricken." Let's go to verse 17. The king on the cross. "And he, bearing his cross, went out to a place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side, and Jesus in the center. Now Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, 'Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews.'" Let's go back to Psalm 22:18. "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." This verse was written by King David. King David was born 1,000 years before Christ. Okay. Let's go back to verse 20. "Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore, the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, 'Do not write the King of the Jews.' But he said, 'But he said, I am the King of the Jews.'" That's their suggestion to Pilate. And all of a sudden, Pilate developed a spine. He answered and said, "What I have written, I have written." 23. "Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts." They divided his garments, "to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, 'Let us tear it.' Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.' Therefore the soldiers did these things." It fulfilled the prophecy of King David. "Behold your mother." Now verse 25. "Now there stood at the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing there, standing by," which, as you remember, this is written by John. And he loves this phrase, "the disciple whom Jesus loved." "He said to his mother, 'Woman, behold your son.' Then he said to his disciples, 'Behold your mother.' And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home." Jesus, even in his hour of suffering, never forgot to honor his mother. In Exodus 20, verse 12, what did it say there? Honor thy father and thy mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. Are we honoring our parents? We should. Jesus is our example, right? Mm-hmm. It is finished. Verse 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and he filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it in his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up the spirit. Jesus refused the wine, according to Matthew. It doesn't say here in John. But in Matthew 27:34, as soon as Jesus tasted the sour wine, he refused it. It simply means that we should remember that our mind is the agency through which the Holy Spirit can talk to us. It can impress us. And Jesus, in his hour of need, doesn't want anything to cloud his thinking. Jesus' side is pierced. 31. Therefore, because it was the preparation day that the bodies should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, which is Passover, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who was crucified with him. Going back to crucifixion, ultimately death occurs through a combination of constrained blood circulation, organ failure, and by asphyxiation. What is asphyxiation? It simply means lack of oxygen. Lack of oxygen. As the body is constrained under its own weight, and death could be hastened by shattering the legs of the victim with an iron club, thereby preventing him from supporting his body's weight and made inhalation more difficult, accelerating both asphyxiation and shock, and of course, with no oxygen, the victim dies easily. When the soldiers came to Jesus, they found out that he has been dead already. Usually, victims of crucifixion live for at least 6 hours. That's the minimum. But Jesus died after 3 hours. He died of a broken heart. That's what the Bible said, right? Let's go back to verse 34. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. And he who has seen has testified, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth so that you may believe. Usually, when a person is still alive and you pierce his body with a spear, only blood comes out. When you see blood and water come out from a person's wound, it simply means that he is dead. He or had been dead for a while. Verse 36, For these things were done that the scripture might should be fulfilled, not one of his bones shall be broken. And again, another scripture says, they shall look on him whom they pierced. Exodus 12:46, what does it say there? This is going back to the start of Passover in Egypt, right? When the Israelites, together led out by Moses, went out of Egypt to the promised land. It says there, this is the command of God while eating the Passover lamb. In one house it shall not be eaten. You shall not carry any of the flesh outside the house, nor shall you break one of its bones. Psalm 24:20, it says there, he, which means God, guards all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Jesus buried in Joseph's tomb. Verse 38, after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him permission, so he came and took the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. Then they took the body of Jesus, bound it in strips of linen with the spices, as was the custom of the Jews it is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So there they laid Jesus because of the Jews' preparation day, for the tomb was nearby. In Isaiah 53:9, it says there, and they made his grave with the wicked, the two thieves beside him. Then it says, but the rich at his death, because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. That is the prophecy from Isaiah. He lived 700 years before the crucifixion of Jesus. That's the end of the chapter. The question for Pilate on that fateful Good Friday, and for each of us today, is what am I to do with Christ? Just reading through that chapter, did your love for our Savior quicken or deepen? Did you see his great sacrifice for us? Is your confidence in him more constant and steadfast? Your love more ardent? Have we learned the lesson of penitence and humiliation at the foot of the cross? Why did Jesus have to die? Well, 1 Corinthians 15:3 says, for I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Romans 5:6, for when we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. 1 Peter 2:24, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, and by whose stripes you were healed. 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Now the next question is this: What do we benefit from Jesus' crucifixion? There are some conditions, right? Of course, John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life." If somebody gives you a check and you believe that it is real, would you go to the bank and cash it or no? The same thing with our belief in Christ. Mark 1:15, it says, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." We should repent of all our sins, right? Because in 1 John 1:9, it says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." So what am I to do with Jesus? I'm going to read again Hebrews 12:1-2, which Pastor Sudhakar read. "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us." Let us run with patience, right? "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before Him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Let us pray, brothers and sisters. Thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice that you have in Calvary. And now, I pray that your love will touch each one of us, that our faith in you would be ardent and constant, and that we would learn a life of penitence and also a life of self-humiliation, that no pride can be seen in our lives, dear Father. Thank you for answering our prayers in Jesus' name.
Please stand with us as we sing our closing hymn, number 329, "Take the World, But Give Me Jesus."
Our great God and Heavenly Father, thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus did for us, where he has come and laid up his life for the sins of the world. And now, dear Father, help us to grasp that promise in faith, knowing that you have cleansed us from all our sins, and that from now on and forever we would be walking with you until you come for the second time and bring us back home to heaven with you. And as you dismiss us from your church, dear Father, we pray that you will be with us for the rest of the Sabbath and for the Sabbath school. Thank you for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Invited to join us for Sabbath school.